everyone, HealthX is a complete healthcare hub which operates with the objective of driving solution to existing hitches and nurturing futuristic advancement in the healthcare industry. On all that said and done, today we have two eminent speakers, Dr. Renuka and Ms. Anju Arora. So we'll start with Ms. Anju Arora today. She is a periodpreneur, period coach, NLP master practitioner, founder, director of Period Hub, and founder of NARI Women Wellness Initiative. So we request you to enlighten us for HealthX today, Ms. Anju Arora. So I'm going to unmute you now. Yes.
Thank you, Shanmati. Good evening, everyone. Good evening, team Redefined. Thank you for having me today. As Shanmati shared about me, I am the founder director of Period Hub, and Period Hub is India's first platform which is offering holistic and natural and sustainable period care products for women. So I have been working in space of sustainable menstrual health from last 6.5 years. And just about 2 years ago, me and my current co-founder, Chirantana, we started pondering on how the period care was confined to only on managing the flow, and it was very reductionist in the approach, that it was just about managing the flow, use pads and get done with it. There was hardly any emphasis of how women should take care of their health, how women should address the discomforts that they face during this time. So that is what we thought, and we kind of were thinking that what if we could provide a platform which could bring all the period care needs of women under one roof, and when women come on that platform, they find something or the other addressing their period needs. And that is how Period Hub was born and conceptualized, I would say. So, I have experience of working with girls and women for over 6 years. And as I said, Chirantana, my co-founder, she is also an environmental engineer. She is, she's a water and sanitation, water sanitation hygiene expert. She's also a US consulate alumni. So she's got a very extensive experience of working with women at grassroots as well on these topics. And that is how, when we combine both our learnings, we combine both our findings and interactions, we really realize that probably Period Hub could be one of the solutions for women's period care needs. And that is how, we thought of Period Hub and we started working on it. So, the ideology that we bring forth is period care is really not just about the 5 days, that you bleed. It is in fact about how well you take care of yourself during the 25 days, that these 5 days are seamless. So, and taking care of yourself during these 25 days just not means, taking care of your, one aspect of your existence. It means it means to take care of your health. It means to take care of your food choices, lifestyle choices, your emotional well-being, your mental well-being. How mindful are you? How present are you? So, taking care of yourself holistically means encompassing all of these things and taking care of yourself wholly. And that is what we wanted to bring forth through Period Hub. At this time, what we are trying to do is we have certain products which are helping women to manage and address their period discomforts. One of the very, very few and very basic products that are available with us is menstrual cups and reusable cloth pads and disposable cloth pads that that women find very convenient to use, because of we enlighten them how these conventional pads that are available in the market are harmful for our health, harmful for our environment, how they are approximately 90% made up of plastics, and how they are literally impacting your health in so many different ways. So cloth pads and menstrual cups becomes a very obvious choice for women to then explore. That is what we provide them with. We also provide them with options like a rash cream, a period salve, because you use pads for a longer period of time, it is so obvious to get rashes. So as part of, again, period conditioning, the women are so quiet about the fact that if I'm getting rashes, it is probably a problem in my body. So, they would not talk openly about it. And bringing a product like Period Salve is an effort to let women know that it is absolutely fine to talk about it, to demand a solution for that, that kind of a discomfort. Then there are period cramp roll-on. Getting cramps during the periods or before periods is very normal because of the lifestyles that we lead, because of the food choices we have. And then you just can't curse periods for all the time for having it. So, rather we should be able, we should be empowered enough to manage these discomforts. So that is why we bring Sutra, the cramp relief roll-on, which is made up of a blend of very exotic herbs and essential oils, which have been used traditionally to take care of the period cramps. And then we have body oils to help you feel rejuvenated, to help you feel relaxed during your periods and normally as well. We have products like Sokya, the snuggle bag. So snuggle bag is helpful for you to take care of your cramps. You just microwave it in the, microwave it for a couple of minutes and, do a warm compress with it, and it will just relieve you from the soreness or cramps that you experience. We have herbal brews, herbal brews like rose and chamomile tea, lavender and mint tea, hibiscus and mint tea. So these are all, these all have been curated with a specific objective in mind, that women, that no period should be a painful period or a discomforting period, and women should be able to address these discomforts, whatever they experience during periods or before the onset of their periods.
Thank you very much, Ms. Anju Arora. Like, as you said, it's a part and parcel of women's life until menopause, right? So, apart from personal importance, this phenomenon also has a significant social impact. And also, menstrual hygiene is a practice where during menstruation, we prevent from this infection from the reproductive parts and the urinary tract infection, a lot of things. So talking about it, I have one question from one of the audience. They were asking, what makes sanitary napkins so absorbent? Previously it was cotton based, and now it's we see more smells and a lot of fragrance coming. And what is it actually, ma'am? What makes sanitary pads more absorbent?
It's a very wonderful question. Thank you for asking this question and giving me opportunity to talk about it. The ads that we see on the television, that it has a leak-proof technology, a gel technology, new improvised technology. So this is nothing but super absorbent polymers, which are derived from the plastic derivatives. And these are actually the absorbent chemicals in the pad, which, which absorbs the fluid so much that, if you accidentally put it in the flush, it can literally block your drainage, because it has the tendency to just keep swelling and swelling like a balloon, and just absorbing the fluid and the moisture around. And that is one of the reasons that, when you use these modern day commercial pads, you perhaps end up using them for a longer period of time. And so while you are exposing yourself to the chemical in the pad, you are also you know, being in contact with the with the blood that is coming out of your body, and after a few hours it does start to become contaminated, and you know, it becomes a perfect breeding ground for the bacterial and the yeast infections. So this is one of the flip sides of using pads which are embedded with which are made with super absorbent polymers. And then there have been certain researches on Google which do talk about which link these super absorbent polymers to infertility in women, because yes, these are the chemicals, you know, when you expose yourself to these chemicals in the pad, they are touching the most sensitive part of your body, and from there the chemical starts to travel up into your body. You know, they've got a direct passage into your body, and they just start to get deposited in your reproductive organs, and that is why there are a lot of health issues and a lot of abnormal functioning disorders when it comes to reproductive health. So you know, there are some very evident research articles available on internet.
Wonderful, ma'am. While you were talking, there was another audience saying that it is called SAP. Is it right? They convert into gel. Okay. Okay. So thank you.
Yeah, super absorbent polymer is SAP. And okay. Yeah. So you know, those are little granules. When they start to absorb the liquid, they just start to swell up. So, you know, I'm not sure, you would never want to cut open a used pad, but yes, perhaps, you know, small children in your homes, you may have observed their diapers, you know, if they use the diapers for a very long time and, you know, they just get torn from probably one of the sides, there is some kind of, you know, gel that comes out, that is super absorbent polymer.
Wonderful. Thank you for answering that question, ma'am. And you have one more question Anu, I guess. So the question is, are plant-based biodegradable sanitary napkins better than the synthetic ones?
So, you know, biodegradable is a term which is used in a very, I would say, loose fashion today, in these days, because everything is biodegradable and nothing is biodegradable. So, you know, biodegradable is what degrades in environment. So everything degrades in environment, but does it decompose? So, you know, a cotton or a cloth, it does get decomposed in environment, but a pad which has, you know, even a slightest of, plastic lining, whether it is a back adhesive or it is, you know, just the wings of the pads, there is that plastic component, and in that sense it is not decompostable. You know, it okay. is biodegradable. Yes, everything in that sense is biodegradable, but is it really compostable? That is the question we have to ask. With biodegradable pads that are available in the market, one of the things that manufacturers, claim that it gets, degraded in 90 days. Yes, it does. But after 90 days, if you observe the place where it was, put down, you would really realize that it is broken down into very small pieces, perhaps, but it has not vanished. It has not become part of that soil. Unless it has not become part of that soil, it is still there in the environment.
Yes, it's not biodegradable.
Exactly. And then in that sense, it is still creating some or the other kind of pollution.
Okay. And I think one more question you have. Ma'am, we are talking about tampons, pads. So please tell us about period panties.
Okay. So period panties are a wonderful option. So, you know, I in fact have a cloth pad with me here, if you can see. So this is a cloth pad made up of, you know, just the cotton fabric and a leakproof fabric. And, a fabric like this, a padding like this is embedded in the period underwear. So it is just sewn inside. It is stitched inside the period panty, and you use it just like a normal underwear. You don't have to use a pad, and it's a very convenient and a very comfortable product. So you know, probably for young girls, for postpartum women, for women who are perhaps menopausing, it is a blessing because you don't have to, you know, use pads for longer times. You don't get rashes. You know, you just change the period underwear just like your normal underwear, wash it like your normal underwear, and you are sorted and good to go.
And does that come for the lighter and heavier days, like in conjunction for the, yes, like another pad solutions, we have XL sizes and all, right? So does this come with sizes as well?
Absolutely. So there are various sizes, different sizes available in the market. You know, just like your normal underwear sizes, small to extra small to medium, large, XL, double XL. There are variants in the sizes available. Along with that, there is also variants available in the amount of flow. So if you're looking for very light flow days, there will be period panties which are, you know, for a very light flow absorption, and then there will be underwears which are with heavy padding that would help you for your heavy bleeding days.
Okay, Raj, she has come up with a question, like, what do you think of smokeless incinerators? Could it be a better solution? It could avoid dumping of pads which causes pollution.
Absolutely. So, you know, if there could be something, so incinerator in a basic layman term that I understand is something that we are incinerating at a certain temperature. So, you know, even for the pads, till now, what I understand for these plastic pads is they have to be incinerated at a certain temperature for them to be really ineffective in the environment. If they are not incinerated at that temperature, then that entire activity is probably another sham. You know, we're just burning that. We are now, you know, burning them along with the dioxins that are available in the pad and the contaminated blood that is available, you know, that is there in the pad. We are burning that and we are polluting the environment. But if there could be something, you know, which is really incinerating these pads at a specific temperature, which is also ensuring that there is no smoke released in the environment, I think that could be one of the solutions to taking care of, you know, pad incineration.
So you're talking about incinerators. Now we are like having like domestic and commercial kind of incinerators. So like, do you think it is like a period product? How do you have a sanitary napkin, and how do you have your menstrual cup at on place every month? Should every house have a domestic incinerator? What do you think about it, ma'am?
So, you know, from the line of work that I have been doing from last 6 years, I have been really encouraging women to use, you know, sustainable means of managing menstruation. This is definitely a movement which cannot take place overnight. It will definitely take time for women to, you know, to get used to the terms that, yes, sustainable is the way forward. And, you know, during that time, there will be many women who would perhaps continue to use disposable products because of any kind of limitations they may have, or any kind of you know, reasons that they may have. And again, it becomes a very personal preference of what period product do I want to use, and what, you know, what do I feel comfortable with. And if I am the one who's using disposable product, then yes, I should also have the option to dispose it in a condition which is harmless for the environment. So yes, if there is something which is harmless for my health, which is harmless for my environment, definitely women would, you know, would want to explore and would want to, you know, take chance for it.
Wonderful, wonderfully said, Ms. Anjur. Like, the myths and taboos about menstruation continue to persist. And it's like a stigma for girls. And thank you for educating about the products which you have been telling us. And it was really wonderful connecting with you. It is not just about the education you give to the girls, the audience we have right now. It is more about like the period panties. I don't think young girls would know about it. And there was one person, and they have that in the back of the mind, and somebody, if like you, if they could educate them on these terms, it is wonderful. So we had a wonderful, thank you for demystifying the menstruation for us, I would say. So thank you for the wonderful session. Next, I'd like to... and gynecologist from KTVR Group of Hospitals. So over to you, ma'am. Please enlighten us, as Ms. Anju just told, she has done a few of demystifying the menstruation process. So we would like to hear from you for Redefine today, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. I'll just share my screen, madam.
Yes, ma'am. I'll make you a co-host. Give me 1 minute, ma'am, so that you can share your screen.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am, you can share it now. Already shared, ma'am. We can see the screen.
Shared. Okay, yes. You can see. Okay, yes. Okay, yes. Ma'am. Okay. Today I'm going to talk on polycystic ovarian syndrome, ma'am.
Yes, are ma'am. PCOS. Yes, ma'am. I can hear you.
Yeah. I am Dr. Renuka. I'm an obstetrician and gynecologist. I'm working in KTVR Hospital, Sai Baba Colony, Coimbatore. And today I'm going to talk on polycystic ovarian syndrome, as I see a lot of people suffering from this problem nowadays. Are you able to hear me, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am, loud and clear. Please
go ahead. Okay. What is PCOS? It's actually an hormonal disorder. It is due to excess production of androgens, that is male hormones. So it results in the formation of multiple cysts, which leads to enlarged ovaries. The cause of polycystic ovary syndrome is not well understood, but it might involve a combination of genetic and environmental factors. The prevalence of this polycystic ovarian syndrome is around 5 to 15%. That is, 1 in 5 women suffer from polycystic ovarian syndrome nowadays. It is one of the most common endocrine disorder in women of reproductive age group worldwide. The risk factors are, it is commonly seen among first degree relatives, mother and daughter can have the same problem. Sometimes sisters can have the same problem. They might be twins also. So it runs in families also. Sometimes environmental influences are also there, where because of the sedentary lifestyle and their diet pattern, like eating junk food and processed foods, leading an idle sedentary life can lead to obesity. And because of obesity, it can result in polycystic ovaries. This is a picture of ultrasound picture of a polycystic ovary. See, you can see the follicles, multiple cysts or multiple follicles in the ovary. Usually, they will present with irregular periods, that is less than 9 periods per year. Sometimes the cycles will be lengthened, it will be more than 35 days. Usually, the cycles will be within 35 days. But in a woman with PCOS, the cycles will be more than 35 days. They will have irregular periods. Then they can have acne, that is pimples on their face. Then they can suffer from hirsutism, that is abnormal growth of hair over the face, the chin, the upper lip, and lower abdomen. They can also have alopecia, that is thinning of hair and male pattern of baldness. They can even have acanthosis nigricans, that is thick velvety patches of skin discoloration over the sides of their neck and back of their neck. And most of the people will present with infertility problems. That is soon after marriage, there will be problem with conception. Usually we ask them to try for at least 6 months. But a woman who is suffering from polycystic ovaries is advised to come for an infertility workup if they don't conceive after trying for 6 months after marriage. Usually in women who have PCOS, they can suffer from other associated factors also, like metabolic syndrome, that is raised blood pressure. Their blood pressure will be more than 130 by 85 millimeters of mercury, and they will have raised triglyceride levels and increased waist circumference, that is more than 88 centimeters or 35 inches. Because of insulin resistance, they will have an impaired glucose tolerance and they can be type 2 diabetic. Because of obesity, they will suffer from obstructive sleep apnea. They can also have non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. Because of their irregular periods, they can suffer from endometrial cancers later in life. They are more prone for cardiovascular disease. Sometimes they even suffer from depression and anxiety. So for treatment of this problem, the main modality is lifestyle modification, that is diet. They have to avoid all junk food and processed food, and they have to concentrate on their weight. They have to reduce at least 5 to 10% of their weight so that they should regularize their periods. They have to have regular exercise, at least 150 minutes of exercise per week. And depending upon their problem, we use to give them treatment either with combined oral contraceptive pills to regularize their periods. Sometimes if their main problem is unwanted growth of hair, then we prescribe them anti-androgens. If they come with a problem like infertility, we put them on ovulation induction drugs. We advise them diet, exercise, and then we give them even tablets like metformin to reduce their, which helps them in reducing their weight. And we even prescribe myo-inositol, d-chiro-inositol tablets, which will increase their ovum quality and help them in getting conceived yearly. So depending upon their problem, we advise them the treatment modality. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. So in midst of you talking, we have one interesting question. So does PCOS and this thyroidism, so this girl has hypothyroidism. So like, how does it like, does that make PCOS worse? Symptoms worse?
Yes, madam. Sometimes women with PCOS can also suffer from thyroid abnormalities also. Since these are all hormones and they are interconnected, a person with polycystic ovaries can have a problem with their thyroid also, with their thyroid profile. They can have hypothyroidism. They can suffer from prolactin problems also, hypoprolactinemia, where their prolactin levels will be elevated. And sometimes their thyroid levels, TSH levels will be reduced. So depending on that, we will give treatment for hypothyroidism. We will put them on thyroxine tablets and we will recheck their TSH levels.
Okay, super. So I hope that answered the audience. And there's one more question, I have PCOS and should I see a fertility doctor before trying to conceive? So as you just told, you will try for 6 months and you'll go for... it is a fertility doctor or a gynecologist? So she's asking,
it is better to see.
Yes, ma'am.
She can meet a gynecologist or a fertility doctor. It is better to see a fertility doctor if her major problem is to conceive. If before marriage, if her problem is like to rectify the irregular periods, if there is excessive growth of hair, facial hair like that, she can meet a gynecologist. That will do. But after marriage, if the main problem is infertility, it is better to meet an infertility specialist.
Okay.
Wonderful. For that problem.
Wonderful. Thank you for answering okay. that.
And thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, we have two other questions, ma'am. Sorry. So,
yes, ma'am.
What are
yes,
certain
ma'am.
Hygiene habits to be followed by women during menstruation?
They have to, during menstruation, they have to they have to change their sanitary pads regularly. We usually advise them to change their pads once in 6 hours. Mm-hmm. If they use tampons, it is better to change them at least once in 2 hours. And then they have to dispose it off properly. They have to pack it up in a plastic paper or a newspaper and then dispose it off properly. And then they have to wash their private parts well, and then they have to change their pads regularly. Okay. And it is better to avoid intercourse during menstruation because there will be more chance of infection during that time.
Okay, wonderful. So, and one more question is, what causes hormonal imbalance? Is it just the food or is it just the lifestyle? So how, what does, what causes, what is the major factor that affects the hormonal imbalance in women?
Actually, it is multifactorial, madam. It depends upon the person's diet habits, their exercise levels, and then their weight. We use to calculate their body mass index depending upon their height and weight. We have a formula. And if a person is 160 centimeters in height, then their ideal body weight will be 60 kg. But sometimes in PCO, people will be on the higher side. They might be 80 kg or 90 kg. So we will advise them to reduce their weight. Even 5 to 10% of reduction in their weight will benefit them. Their problem will get solved sometimes. Their periods will get regularized and all the hormonal problems will get reduced and their hormonal imbalance will get changed. These problems will get rectified actually.
Wonderful. And yes. There's one more question, ma'am. So
yes,
the solutions like diet, exercise, and you know, they people take nutritional supplementations for weight reduction, maybe the hormonal supplementation. And after all this, if even the PCOS is not cured, is surgery necessary, ma'am? Surgery considered only as
option? It is the last modality, madam. In fact, surgery will reduce the, it will reduce their fertility also. Sometimes the ovarian reserve will get reduced. Only if other options doesn't work out, then the last modality will be laparoscopic ovarian drilling surgery. Initially, we advise them on lifestyle modification, diet, exercise, and we give them medications for PCO, and we see whether it is working out. The last resort is surgery. Sometimes if surgery can even worsen the problem if it comes to infertility. When the ovarian reserve is less, then it will become a very big problem for them to conceive. We used to measure the hormone levels also, AMH, anti-Müllerian hormone levels, in people suffering from infertility. And sometimes after surgery, their AMH levels will become very low where eggs will not be produced. So they won't be able to conceive. So it might sometimes worsen the problem. So surgery will be the last modality.
Okay.
Well, if their problem is infertility and if they have tried out everything, I mean, all the medications, diet, exercise, and then they are not able to conceive, then we suggest them laparoscopic ovarian drilling as the last modality. Okay.
Wonderful, ma'am. So for Ms. Anju and both Renuka, ma'am, what is the interval to change pads? The flow, as ma'am just said, 6 hours. And the flow differs from one woman to another, but it is not okay for ma'am to use the same pad for many hours together. Is it true?
It is better to change the pad regularly, ma'am. It is not advisable to use the same pad for a long time. And it won't be hygienic also. So it is better to change the pads regularly.
Okay. Anju, ma'am, your views about it?
Yeah, sure. You know, I would like to add to what Dr. Renita shared here. It is definitely advisable to change pads regularly. You know, one rule that every woman or every girl can really apply is ensuring that you are not using the pads for more than 6 hours. Whether it is a light flow day or a heavy flow day, ensure after 6 hours you are really, you know, disposing of the used pad. Whether it is a reusable cloth pad or a disposable cloth pad, ensure that you are changing to a fresh clean pad at least after 6 hours. And, you know, the same goes for menstrual cup as well. So, you know, if you're using a product like menstrual cup, probably on a lighter flow day, it is all right to keep it, for 8 to 10 hours. On heavier flow day, you know, you may have to take it out soon. You may have to empty it early and, you know, you will have to just clean it and put it back inside. But in cases, even when you're using a menstrual cup, should not use a cup for more than 10 hours. Take it out once at least in 10 hours, clean it and then reinsert.
Wonderful, ma'am. Thank you for answering that. And Renuka, ma'am, you have one question. Like, what is it okay, like ma'am. Getting two periods in 1 month? Like, I mean, why does that happen? Like getting two periods in 1 month?
Sometimes some people will have two periods in a month. It might also be an indication of some cyst in their ovaries. Some we call it as polymenorrhea. If they have two periods in 1 month, then they have to investigate. They have to meet a gynecologist. And if they have that problem regularly, if it's one cycle, then it's okay. If every cycle is there like that, then they have to investigate. They have to check with the gynecologist. Then we used to see an ultrasound and check whether the uterus, the ovaries are all normal. And then we used to prescribe them depending upon the problem. We have to prescribe medications. Okay.
Okay, ma'am. Anju, ma'am, there's one more question. Like the menstrual cloths, right? So when you use menstrual cups, you have just shown the cups for the audience. So menstrual cloths, does menstrual cups affect this menstrual cloths or is it very messy? So that is a question.
So using a menstrual cup or a cloth pad is not at all messy. You know, when you are using a cloth pad, it is just like using a normal sanitary pad that you use. It's just that, you know, you will take it out and you will wash it. And, you know, to this, I would like to invite audience to reflect on the fact that when you know, your underwears get stained or your bedsheet gets stained, you don't dispose them. You wash them, you reuse them. So similarly, you know, there is really should not be any reservation in being able to use a cloth pad. And similarly, it goes with menstrual cup. So, you know, when you are using the menstrual cup first, there is a very, famous inhibition and reservation among women that I may get in contact with my own blood. It may spill. It may, you know, I may just get in contact with it. You know, one thing that I want all women to get clear with is this is your own blood. You know, if you are a young girl, tomorrow this will be the blood that will nurture your baby inside. If you are a woman, this is the same blood that has given birth to this, you know, to the nurtured your baby in your womb. So there is literally nothing to feel grossed out about the blood. You know, if you get cut on your hand or any part of your body and you bleed from there, you don't feel grossed out at looking at that blood. It's absolutely normal for you. But when you are bleeding, when you are having your periods, you feel so grossed out about that blood. So, you know, Dr. Renuka is also there. She can also, validate this fact. This blood that we bleed out is rather one of the nutritious blood loss that happens during the period. You know, the same blood that nourishes our baby. yes, you know, when it is coming out, it does become contaminated. And so, you know, that holds true for any other part of the body from where we bleed. But there is nothing to be grossed out about, you know, this blood that we shed during this. Once you shed this inhibition, shed this motion, there will actually be no diet being able to use the menstrual cup or cloth.
Ma'am, what is your thoughts about it? Like, young girls think, yes, it is like a dirty blood, so like it is like a clot. So Anju ma'am was just telling it is a blood which nourishes your baby when you're pregnant. So please share your thoughts.
Yes,
about
ma'am. Yes, sir. Yeah, they should change their attitude, actually. They should not think like that. In fact, it is the blood that nourishes their baby in their womb. Even that blood goes to the baby through the placenta, and it helps the baby to grow in their womb. In fact, so they should not think like that. They have to erase that idea from that mind. They have to change their attitude, actually. Okay,
ma'am. Ma'am, actually, you have one more question.
Okay.
Does having PCOS will bring calcification for the baby in womb? I mean, womb. Is that true? Like, I don't know what is calcification.
No, it is not. Calcification, like calcification is like calcification of the placenta, I think. The question relates to calcifications. We usually see calcifications in the placenta. Calcifications in the placenta occur due to reduced blood flow. Actually, placenta is the main this thing between the mother and the baby. It nourishes the baby. It transmits all the nutrients to the baby and collects back all the waste products also. So it is the major organ. So if a pregnant mother is having hypertension during pregnancy, or that will reduce the blood flow. Because the arteries, there will be vasospasm, constriction of the arteries. So the amount of blood flowing through the arteries will reduce, and that will lead to calcifications in the placenta. When there are calcifications in the placenta, then the baby's growth will get restricted. Sometimes the baby's weight will get reduced, and we have to watch the baby's growth vigilantly when there are calcifications in the placenta. We have to be more vigilant, and we have to deliver the baby safely.
Okay.
And there is no connection with PCOS as such. PCOS is a different one, and calcification of the placenta is a different topic. PCOS won't lead to calcification, but a person with PCOS, because of her obesity, can land up with hypertension complicating pregnancy. And because of that hypertension, they can have calcifications in the placenta. It is interrelated.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you, ma'am. That
was interrelated.
It's like a mysterious thread. So it is like, it's as you said, interrelated.
Okay.
So thank you for answering.
Interrelated. Okay, ma'am.
Anju ma'am, you have one question. So how do we prepare our girls for their first period? Like, in many rural parts, it is still considered impure, and the girls see it as like a mere shock.
So, you know, it is really not about the rural girl or an urban girl. It is really about the conditioning that conditioning about periods that is present in our society. So, it really becomes the responsibility of all of us as a community to talk to young girls about periods in a very positive way. Rather than imposing, do's and don'ts when they get into this, age of adolescence and they are about to get experience, rather than looking into that do's and don'ts, if you can teach girls about how this is going to be a beautiful phase of their life, you know, how their bodies are going to change, how they are, going to lead everyone, which is really going to help them connect with their own body. If we teach them positive aspects about females, they would definitely become a more confident and a more resilient human beings, rather than telling them, oh, you've got period, this happens to every woman, this is like a curse, so ye mat karo, you know, you don't talk to your boys, you don't talk to your the men of your family and tell them that you're getting your period. So instead of sharing these inhibitions, we empower girls with the knowledge that this is one of the most important phases that you are getting into. This is going to be the beautiful phase of your life. It will really change their perception about the onset of period. This is what I feel is important. You know, it is now time to talk to girls, our young girls, about periods in a very positive way.
Okay. Ma'am, please, sir, share us about this stringless tampons.
Stringless tampons?
Yes.
So, tampons in itself, you know, is a device, is a product that has to be inserted inside the vaginal canal, right? Now, there are tampons which are available with strings that you can pull out. And, so what happens with tampons is, when the tampons get inside the body, they get inside the vaginal canal, they start to absorb the blood, they start to absorb the fluid, and they start to swell up so that there is no leakage and they absorb the blood and you don't need to use a pad. So that is, you know, a tampon. And I am assuming stringless tampon is something that does not have a string and you can just, pull it out without the string, because many women have felt that strings are very uncomfortable, you know, and they just keep running and it becomes very difficult for them to use tampons at times. And, you know, a lot of women have also complained about, being able to use a tampon, that when they use a tampon, there is a lot of vaginal dryness and itchiness when they use it, because understand, when the tampon is inside the vaginal canal, it is not just absorbing the blood, it is also absorbing the essential vaginal moisture that is there on your mucous walls. So that is why it leads to dryness and itchiness when you're using a tampon. So I really tell people, I really tell girls and women that if you are using a tampon, you might as well want to consider using a cup, because you are anyways inserting a tampon inside. So, just give it a thought, use a cup. A cup is made up of, medical grade silicone. It does not impact with the vaginal moisture inside. It's just collecting the blood and you are disposing it off, and, you're washing it off. So that's about tampons. And Shanmati, there is one question, that I was going through and which I would really like to answer. Is it advisable to use any vagina hygiene products during periods? So I would really like to clarify this, that first of all, understand that vagina is a self-cleaning organ in our body. It really has a lot of healthy bacteria inside, and it really does not need anything to cleanse it. It cleanses itself and throws out what is not needed there in form of the vaginal discharge. Now, do you need anything to clean your vagina? Absolutely not. But, there is a very, there is a lack of awareness among girls and women in trying to understand that perhaps what they call vagina is not the vagina, is rather the outer part or the groin area, which is called the vulva, which is, which is the skin folds just along with the vaginal opening. That is where sometimes, the vaginal discharge gets deposited, or, if you are peeing, your urine traces get trapped in the, pubic hair, or, during your periods, there are some traces of blood that gets trapped. So that is the part, the groin area, the vulva area, that needs a little care and little attention. And that is why it is very important that you clean your vulva and you clean your intimate parts with a very mild intimate wash, but you don't need anything for your vagina. Please, you do not need anything for your vagina. You do not need to put any cleansing products inside your vaginal cavity.
Wonderful, wonderful. A lot of discussions. I'm pretty sure like a lot of inputs and a lot of understanding of the entirety of the MHM today. So it's more like a doctor, an obstetrician, gynecologist, and such a wonderful answer from Anju, ma'am, for all the products, period products. So it's actually like how HealthX envisions a future for where all people, regardless of the financial and geographical differences, we access to basic health information and facts. And you, both panelists, Ms. Anju Arora and Dr. Renuka, has added an enlightening and entertaining presentation on the right way to get into MHM. So I would always call it like a mysterious area. So you, as a panelist, has clarified the mysterious area. So your advice on the period products and the PCOS, which is actually becoming a trend right now. I would not say that's a healthiest trend, but as ma'am said few facts, it's becoming a trend. So every other person is PCOS affected. So, and young girls exposed to a lot of junk food, and yes, it was actually a very nice presentation, and a lot of girls would have understand about what MHM and what is PCOS and what is period products, like about the period panties and tampons and menstrual cups, which that would be a nightmare for a lot of students. So thank you, and the audience have learned a lot from you, and it was a wonderful session from both the panelists today. We are much grateful to have you on today's session, and thank you for attending today's Redefine panel, and thank you Dr. Renuka and Ms. Anju Arora. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you so much for having me. Thank you.